Biology was always my favorite subject growing up. I'm not sure exactly why. Maybe it was just because of this inherent connection and interest in nature. Maybe that came from my mom, maybe that came from where I grew up, but I just always loved biology class. I went to the Antarctic 5 times. 4 times was for my PhD research. I was working at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography, which is part of UC San Diego. We were looking at the diving physiology of animals in general. And the work that we were pursuing then in the Antarctic was looking at the diving physiology of emperor penguins. How they could support this extraordinary behavior, diving deeper than 500 meters and for longer than a half an hour on a single breath. We put physiological data recorders on the animals. I was even fortunate enough to dive where we were doing our research with the penguins, so emperor penguins whizzing around you. You can imagine what an extraordinary feeling that is. And it was just completely eye-opening. And we did measure heart rates as low as 3 beats per minute and down around 5-6 beats per minute for a whole 5-minute period. So that's really extraordinary if you think about comparing that to an exercising human or any animal exercising on the surface of the earth, where, you know, you have this characteristic exercise response, your heart rate increases to get more oxygen and blood flow to all of the exercising tissues and muscles. So these animals are down there, they're also exercising. They're swimming around, they're catching fish, they're foraging, and they're doing that while lowering their heart rate, so it's this really unique dive response. So for my postdoctoral research project, I kind of went to a different extreme. I became very interested in the barheaded goose, which is the species of goose that migrates twice a year over the tallest mountains on the planet, so over the Himalayas. You know, if somebody's thinking about climbing Everest, then they go weeks in advance, they go to base camp, they allow themselves to acclimate, their physiological processes catch up a little bit, get some more red blood cells on board. These birds are doing that crossing in 7 to 8 hours. They need far more oxygen in order to support themselves while they're flying than they would if they were walking or down here at sea level, but they're doing that in an environment that has an oxygen limitation. So how are they doing that? We decided to try and look at this problem by training barheaded geese to fly in a wind tunnel. And in order to make sure that the birds would be comfortable with me and my team, we imprinted the animals. It's particularly strong in waterfowl. So the first thing that a duck or a goose sees after they hatch, they look at as their parental figure, and they imprint. So I got some eggs, and I had the birds imprint on me. So I was there from the time that they hatched. You know, they would be hatching in my hands, coming out of the egg, and I was the first thing they saw. So they thought that I was their mom, and I was a modern day mother goose. I had 12 goslings that were following me around everywhere I went. They look to you for everything. You're going on walks, you're cuddling with them, taking naps. It was really an extraordinary experience to have that connection with an animal. And they grow quite quickly. Within a few months, they had fully grown wings. And so we brought the birds back to the University of British Columbia and started training them to fly in the wind tunnel. And we outfitted them with physiological recorders, little backpack recorders to measure heart rate, and then again, oxygen level. And then they also were outfitted with a mask, so a really lightweight mask that we made out of a dental mold material. And that allowed us to collect the air that they exhaled. And then through that mask, we could also change the amount of oxygen that they were breathing in. So there was a tube where we would flow nitrogen into the mask and basically decrease the overall oxygen level so that we could simulate altitude. So we were flying these birds at about a half to a third of the amount of oxygen that we have at sea level. A third of the amount of oxygen is equivalent to higher than the summit of Mount Everest, so higher than that tallest peak. And interestingly, as we predicted, the birds could still fly. And it really isn't just one adaptation. There is really a host of adaptations all the way through what we call the oxygen transport cascade. So everything from getting the oxygen from the air into their lungs, getting it into their blood, getting it down to the individual cells and into the mitochondria, which are the powerhouses of the cell. So they really have adaptations at every step of the way.
Thank you.
So before I was an astronaut, and actually even before I went to graduate school, I worked here at the Johnson Space Center for 3 years for the Human Research Facility. So our group, we were coordinating all of the life science experiments that were conducted back then on the space shuttle and then also on the space station. And I find that a really interesting connection now because first I was coordinating that kind of science on other astronauts. Secondly, I was doing all these experiments on all these different animals, using the animals as the subjects, and I was the experimenter. And finally, it's come full circle where I will be the one that's experimented upon. And these types of experiments, these physiological and medical experiments, are really important for us in terms of understanding all of the effects of microgravity and the spaceflight environment on the human body. And this will be even more important as we begin to undertake longer missions, when we go back to the moon and eventually go to Mars. You know, with the Artemis program, we are planning those missions now. And it will be even more important for us to make sure that we can deliver astronauts effectively and are they able to function at their destinations, and to make sure that we can get them home safely as well. So by understanding all these processes with the decades of research we have now on the International Space Station, we can conquer and apply that towards these future flights. I'm Jessica Meir. I'm a scientist and a NASA astronaut.
Subscribe for more space.